Hi guys, as most of you requested for EMT videos, so what we are doing is we'll be solving problems based on EMT that have appeared in the previous year GATE electrical examination. So I'll be telling you the concept behind those problems so that you can get well versed with the kind of problems that are asked and how to tackle such kind of problems. So without wasting much time, let us get started. So the first problem, which of the following equation represents the Gauss law? Now, Gauss law in electrostatic, how is Gauss law written? Gauss law is written in two forms. One is the integral form, d dot ds equal to charge enclosed. Here, this quantity is called as the flux through a surface S. Okay, and Q enclosed is charge enclosed by S. S must be a closed surface. Being a closed surface means there is a certain volume that lies inside the surface. Okay. This law can also be written in the differential form. How to write in differential form? It is del dot d vector equal to rho v. Okay, that is the divergence of flux density is equal to the charge density at that point. That is why this can also be written as volume integral rho dv. Is it fine? So d is basically your flux density. This is also called as point form of Gauss law. Point form means this law can be applied at each and every point, and this law can only be applied over a surface S. Next, an electrostatic potential is given in the rectangular coordinate system. We need to find the electric field is at 1, 1. Now, what is the relation of electric field with potential? Electric field is negative of the gradient of potential. Now, how to find this gradient? In rectangular coordinates, gradient is del phi by del x, ax cap, del phi by del y, ay cap, del phi by del z, az cap. Now, del phi by del x, if you take its derivative with respect to x, is 2 root y. What about derivative with respect to y? 2x into 1 by 2 root y. Derivative with respect to z will be 0. So, it is 2 root y ax cap plus x upon root y ay cap. Now, if you put the value of x and y into this, x is 1 as well as y is 1. So, it will be 2ax plus ay. But we only want the magnitude. So, magnitude of electric field. Also, I have not taken, this is your gradient of phi. Electric field is negative of this. So, electric field will be like this. So, what will be magnitude of electric field? Under root 2 square plus 1 square, that is under root 5, that is how much? 2.24 volt per meter. Okay, so always remember to take the negative sign because electric field is negative of the gradient. Okay, in the next one, it is saying when a charge is given to a conductor, the first option, it distributes uniformly over the surface, it distributes uniformly over the volume, it distributes on the surface inversely proportional to the radius, it stays where it is placed. So, what is a special property of a conductor? In a perfect conductor, no charge resides in the volume. Why is it so? Because if Q exists inside the volume, then it will create some electric field inside. This electric field, it will push charge to the surface. So as long as charge is inside, there will be an electric field which will be pushing the charge to the surface. So if the entire charge goes to the surface, if Q goes to the surface, electric field inside the conductor would be zero. If electric field is zero, force on charge is zero. If force is zero, then it is static, or we can say we have reached steady state. Is it fine? That is why in a conductor, electric field inside the conductor is zero and the charge distributes uniformly all over the surface. In the next one, in electrostatic field, del cross E equal to zero. In electrostatic field, basically, it is electric field due to Q. And in that case, the electric field is conservative. What do you mean by conservative field? First of all, a conservative field means that the work done by this field is independent of path. The work done is independent of path, which means the line integral E dot dl is path independent. It only depends on initial and final points of the path. It does not depend on the path taken, which means, suppose this is our coordinate axis. If I am going from A to B, the integration from A to B will be same no matter which path you take. Okay, that field is called as conservative field. If the initial and final points are same, that is over a closed curve, then this integration would come out to be zero. Okay, so that means if it is independent of path and you make it a closed loop, then the starting and the terminating point are same. In that case, the line integral would come out to be zero. Now if you apply Stokes' theorem, okay, now if we apply Stokes' theorem, then what happens? Over a closed curve, E dot dl is equal to surface integral del cross E dot ds. Now if this is zero, it means the curl of electric field is zero, which means E is irrotational. Okay, if its curl is zero, it means it is irrotational. Is it fine? So that is how you can say all the electric fields created by charges or the electrostatic fields are conservative in nature. Moving on, a hollow conductor is at potential V, the potential at any point inside the hollow conductor. Okay, see, suppose it is a spherical conductor. It is hollow inside. If it is hollow inside, that is no Q lies inside conductor. Okay, because it is hollow, so there is no material present inside the conductor, so there can be no charge. Now by Gauss law, if there is no charge inside the conductor, the electric field will also be zero. If electric field is zero, electric field is basically how much? Minus gradient of potential. It is zero, which means potential is constant. Okay, because gradient is defined as del V by del X AX cap, del V by del Y AY cap, del V by del Z AZ cap. So if it is coming out to be zero, it means V does not vary with respect to X, Y and Z. So that is why potential at any point inside the hollow is V. Whatever is the potential at the surface will be same as the potential at every point inside, because inside the conductor electric field is zero. Moving on, a spherical conductor of radius A with charge Q is placed concentric inside an uncharged and unearthed outer conducting shell of inner and outer radius R1 and R2. Taking the potential to be zero at infinity, what is the potential at any point within the shell? Now try and understand this concept, okay? So what happens to the inner conductor? You give charge Q. It will reside on the surface of this conductor. But outside, we have a conducting shell like this. Now, as I have told you earlier in one problem, that electric field inside the conductor should be zero. Now, suppose I make a Gaussian surface. I am making the Gaussian surface inside the conductor, if you see, because the radius of Gaussian surface is between R1 and R2. This radius is R1, this one is R2. So I have made a Gaussian surface of radius R such that R lies between R1 and R2. Now what should be electric field at R? It should be zero because it is a conductor. Now by Gauss law we know surface integral d dot ds equal to charge enclosed, or if you multiply d equal to epsilon e basically, so q. If this electric field is zero, it means charge enclosed is zero. But here I see that plus q charge is enclosed, but since the electric field is zero, it gives me that the charge must be zero, which means an equal and opposite charge must be induced at the inner surface of the conductor, which is minus Q. But this spherical shell was uncharged, that is its net charge was zero. Now it is not connected to anything, which means its net charge cannot change. Like if it was connected to a battery, then it can supply a charge. If it was connected to another shell, then it can supply a charge. But here it is not connected anywhere, it is isolated, so its net charge should be zero. Which means if minus Q is induced on the inside, plus Q must be induced on the outside. Okay, so that net charge still remains zero. And if you see the total system, there are three charges, plus Q, minus Q and plus Q. So the total charge is also constant, that is plus Q. So you can apply charge conservation. Basically, the charge on the outer sphere remains zero because it is not connected to any other body, and the charge on the total system remains plus Q. Now it is asking potential at any point P within the shell. Here it is giving as P. Now just now I told you electric field inside a conductor is zero, which means potential is constant. So whatever the potential is at surface is same as the potential on the inside, which means the potential at point P is equal to potential on surface. What is the charge on the surface? Q. What is the radius of the surface? R2. So what will be the answer? C. Okay, whatever is the potential on the surface will be same as the potential on the outer surface, will be same as potential at every point on the inside. Is it fine? The next one, inside a hollow conducting sphere, what I told you, inside a hollow conducting sphere, what happens? Electric field is zero because inside there is no charge, so there can be no electric field. Remember, this is a very basic and very important concept. Now, as you have seen, it has been asked in GATE multiple times. Next, If VWQ stand for voltage, energy and charge, then V can be expressed as. Now, in this case, what happens? The work done in electric field is equal to dQ into dV, the charge into potential difference is equal to change in potential energy, which means change in potential equal to dW by dQ. Okay, that is the answer would be C. Is it fine? The work done in an electric field is equal to the charge transported multiplied by the change in potential. In the next one, in a uniform electric field, field lines and equipotentials, they are orthogonal. First of all, let us understand the meaning of this term equipotential. It means potential at each point is constant. Any surface in which potential is constant at each and every point is said to be equipotential. Now it says uniform electric field, which means electric field is like this. So the equipotential surface will be perpendicular to this. It will be in the form of a sheet. Why? Because on this surface, if you take dr vector, now we know dv equal to minus e dot dr. Since the surface and electric field are orthogonal to each other, E and dr are perpendicular, so dv is 0, or we can say voltage or potential is constant. Is it fine? So the equipotential surfaces are perpendicular to the electric field, so that there is no change in potential between any two points that lie on the surface. So you need to know what are the types of equipotential surface. For point charge, the equipotential surfaces are spherical, because electric field must be always perpendicular to the surface. So for point charge as well as spherical charge, the equipotential surfaces are always spheres. For line charge, it is cylindrical. For sheet charge, it is always sheet, that I showed you here. For line charge, if this is the line charge, equipotential surface will be a cylinder. So you need to remember the nature of equipotential surface for different type of configuration. The next one, it is asking the capacitance of the arrangement. Now one thing that you need to understand, when two dielectrics are placed like this, epsilon 1, epsilon 2, its capacitance is C1, this one is C2. So both are considered to be in series. In series, the equivalent capacitance would be C1, C2 by C1 plus C2. If both dielectrics are placed like this, then the capacitance of epsilon 1 region is C1, epsilon 2 is C2. They are considered to be in parallel. So C equivalent is C1 plus C2. Now if you see, based on this logic, this epsilon 1 and epsilon 2 are in series, and then the combination is in parallel with epsilon 3. So first let us find out C1. C1 will be area. Area is how much? 10 centimeter, because this width is 10 centimeter. Okay. And this width or depth will be 20 centimeter, because it is saying 20 centimeter square conducting plate. So 10 into 20 is the area, into 10 to the power minus 4. Why 10 to the power minus 4? Because the area will be in centimeter square. Epsilon 1 is 1 into 8.85 10 to the power minus 12. The distance between the plates 10 centimeter. Okay. So that will be C1. Then C2. 10, the area will remain same, into 20 into 10 to the power minus 4. Its permittivity is how much? 2. Into 8.85 into 10 to the power minus 12 by 10 into 10 to the power minus 2. Let me call this as C. So this will be 2C. Now these two are in series. So what is C dash? C into 2C by 3C. That is 2C by 3. What about epsilon 3? The area will be same. 10 into 20 into 10 to the power minus 4 into its permittivity 4. 8.85 10 to the power minus 12 divided by the distance between the plates is now 20 centimeter. Okay. So this will be also equal to 2C. Okay. Now the equivalent capacitance. These two are in parallel. So 2C by 3 plus 2C, that is 8C by 3. Where C is this value? So now if you put the value of this C, if you evaluate this and then multiply the value by 8 upon 3, what you will get is 4.72 picofarad. Remember this basic rule how to identify whether the capacitances are in series or in parallel. The simple phenomena is if the dielectrics are divided along the length or the distance between the plates, then it is series. If they are divided along the area, then it is parallel. Okay. So this will be all from this video. More questions we will cover in the next one. Thank you.